discussed about new product development. What are the major things that you need to keep in mind when you are talking about product design? And then we mentioned that function and form are the two important aspects of product design. Okay, what the product is supposed to do is this function, right? And form is how do you provide that function in the product is decided by the form of the product. So the function is sometimes the function is already known. You know what the product has to do, but how do you make that function happen in the product is the challenge. And we found that that is where the creative design comes into picture, that you try to give a particular shape to the product, a particular way the product's function will be happening. So that is how you design new products. So yesterday I asked you a few questions, that what was the what was your most least favorite car, or what is the last product you used bought for you or someone else, and what was the product that fascinated you the most for its innovative design and function. And this today's question is, what is that dream product you would like to see in the markets? So this actually tells you, okay, how good you are as a designer, or what is your imagination as a designer, what would you like to see in the markets? So what will be that dream product you would like to see in the markets? Anybody? So it's already there in the markets. You have to directly go. Oh, okay. So something which you can directly take it into your brain. No. Oh, okay. So something which will give you all the information what you want, you will be able to see it. Okay. Any other products you would like to see? Teleportation. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you can go to wherever you like and you'll be able to see. Yeah, that's a good product. Okay. So you can have, some of you will be having some dream products in mind. Oh, it would be nice if such a product is available in the market, right? You don't need to study. Everything will go to your brain directly so that you can do whatever you like. And then you can get all the information without really reading a book or going through all the notes and slides and other things. No, that may be a good product, right? So like that, you can actually think of many products that will be of interest to you, or that will be a dream product which will help you in many ways. So any product design basically start with you or the customer. Basically, it look at the customer, what actually the customer is looking for. So the product design starts from the customer or you, because we are all customers in one way or the other. So whether you are a design, you are designing or you are using a product, someone has designed for you. So every product design starts from the customer. Now, if you look at the current product that you are using as a customer, you will understand what actually went into the design of that product. So basically we look at what are the things we normally use. So if you look at, you use mobile phone, all of you use mobile phone, right? Is there anyone who don't use mobile phone here? Anybody? No. Okay. So what purpose you use mobile phone? What is the purpose for which you use mobile phone? Watching movie, listening music. Okay, so probably for communication, watching movie, many things you use for your phone, right? Now, the question is, are you satisfied with your phone? How many of you are satisfied with the phone you have? Okay, you are all satisfied. How many of you are not satisfied with the phone you have? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Someone are neutral. They don't have satisfaction or dissatisfaction. So why are you not happy with your phone? You know, I'm talking about the phone. You are saying okay, some of the softwares you cannot implement in your phone. Okay, that may be one thing. And who else said don't like the phone? Who was the other person? Yeah, what is the problem with your phone? Oh, you want this to be lighter and probably more capabilities, more memory, like that. So Now you can see there is a need for a new phone. Some people are saying that, okay, I'm happy with my phone. Some people are saying I'm not happy with my phone. So those who are saying happy with the phone and those who are saying not happy with the phone, both are actually contributing to the new development. Somebody says, I'm happy with the phone. They don't know what is going to come in the next generation of phone. Okay, there may be additional features coming, which you don't ask for, but somebody will think about the capability, the possibilities of designing new product with the new capabilities, so that will come into the market. And those who are saying, I'm not happy with my phone, that says that there is a room for making a better product. Okay, so that is the way how the design thinking goes. Similarly, okay, this is why we answered. How many of you use WhatsApp? Okay. And when WhatsApp was not there, how you were communicating or using this particular function of WhatsApp? Pardon? Text message. But did anyone say that, okay, I'm not happy with my text message, I need a WhatsApp? Nobody said, right? So you were happy with your text messaging and you were not knowing what else is possible with this. So somebody found that, okay, now Wi-Fi is available, phone is available, numbers, this communication network is available. So there is a possibility to bring them together to create a new product, right? So WhatsApp is a product. So we are actually looking at, we don't know that it is possible, but still somebody found that there is a way to develop a product. So is there any other way to meet this need now? Now we are all happy with WhatsApp, right? Do you think something else can actually replace WhatsApp? What else can be the one which can replace WhatsApp? Telegram. Telegram, not the old Telegram, right? The new one. So what is the difference between that and the WhatsApp? What is the difference between Telegram and WhatsApp? No? Okay, so basically the size limits and other capabilities are better in Telegram. Or you get to know the other person, whether he has seen the message. So basically added functionality in the product, right? So now these two examples basically tells you that whether you are happy with the product or not happy with the product, both leads to new product development, right? People were very happy with the old phone, right? Without any smart features. Then somebody brought smartphone, then that's much better than the earlier phone. We just threw the normal phone and then moved to the smartphone. So now we are all saying, oh, I'm happy with the smartphone capabilities. We don't know what is going to come up in the next future, right? People may come up with a better product. So product design happens because of the customer's requirements. And sometimes, even if the customer does not know, customer is not asking for something new, new products will come up in the market. So these are the two ways in which the product comes into the market. And we call it as analytical method and synthetic methods. Okay, so analytic method is basically, you have a problem, you want to solve the problem. Okay, he says the phone is very heavy, you want to have a lighter phone. Or the memory is not sufficient, or the speed is not sufficient. So you have a problem, you try to solve the problem, you analyze an existing problem and find solutions. That is basically known as an analytical method of product development. So you analyze the problem, try to solve the problem. Okay, WhatsApp has got some problem, your mobile phone has got some problem, or your laptop has got some problem. That I'll try to develop a new method and then get the solution. For example, I'm not happy with the projector. See, every time I have to come, I have to connect my laptop with an adapter and then connect the projector, the serial connection. And then I need to set up my computer to accept that. There are a lot of problems for me. So my requirement is that I don't want to have all these issues with me. When I come and switch on the computer and maybe press a button, it should be projected onto the screen. I don't care how it happens. So that is my requirement. So I have a problem. I try to solve it, and that is an analytical way of designing a new product. So you try to solve a problem. The other one is synthetic methods. You don't have any problem as such. You are happy with what you are having, but then you synthesize the product, existing product, and then see what can be added to that, what can be modified, so that you will get a better product. You are not finding any problem per se as such, but you feel that there is a way to improve it. Either the improvement could be because of some technology changes, communication change, or there is a change in the display. So now you have at present what we have is all rigid displays. So someone has developed a flexible display. Now I feel that, oh, there is a potential opportunity for me to change my font with a flexible display. So that is basically a synthetic method of product development. That is, the objective here is to design something even when there is no explicit problem. So nobody has found a problem as such, but we feel that there is a potential opportunity to develop a new product. So you synthesize the existing things and then see what is available in different domains, different technologies. How do we use that one in order to develop a new product? So that is basically known as a synthesis method or synthetic method of designing products. Got it? Now, can you tell me an example for a synthetic product? Pardon? Smartphone, okay. Anything else? Any other product you can say it's a synthetic product? Tablets, okay. Car, okay. Smart key, yeah. Smart keys. Smart TV, okay. So now you, whenever you say this, no, you just analyze, okay, what was the reason or why this product actually came into market. So if you look at every product, so you are using hundreds of products, and you take any product, you will see the birth of that product, how it actually started, how it went on to grow into different stages, and sometimes how did end also. Some products will actually have a natural death. There are many products which will go to a natural death, right? So if you look at your old TVs, how many of you have seen that tube TV? Nowadays you don't see it, that big one, right? Box with big box with a picture tube. What happened to that? Dead, right? It actually went, no more such products are available in the market. Nobody uses that. And what actually came? All your LEDs, LCD, and all those things are coming. Flat TVs are there. So any product you look at or you can try to analyze, you will see a growth of the product and then a death of the product also. Sometimes death, sometimes it is still going on. So let us take few examples to see how a product is born, how it grows, and how it dies. Okay, so we look at a case study of one of these products and then see how it happens in the markets, the birth and growth, or sometimes the death of a new product. We'll take one or two examples to see how this happens in the markets, or what actually leads to the birth of a product and the growth or death of a product. And you will be able to analyze this with every product. Any product you use, you will see that such a growth. Whether you take your pen, your specs, or phone, any product you see, you will be able to analyze the product from its start and the end of the product. So let us take a simple example here and then see how the products grows or born, how a product is born and then how it is grown. So as I told you, the need for a product is felt by somebody, either it's a synthetic method or a analytical method, both ways. Someone will see there is a need for a product. So I'm giving a need here. For centuries, man has been trying to recreate special moments of life. Agree? For centuries, people have been doing this. I have a special moment. I want this moment to be protected for a long time. How was it done long ago? Long ago, very long ago, paintings or stone carvings, people used to carve on the stone, and then later on it went to paintings, right? If you go to museums and all, you will see a lot of old paintings. So there was a need to preserve the precious moments or the history of precious moments, and people have been painting, have been using painting as a medium to achieve this. And there was a, and there were a lot of issues with painting. So painting was, it will take a long time, and people have to be there for a long time for the painter to capture all the details. And there was issue of the painting get spoiled because of either weather conditions or because of various reasons. Therefore, somebody thought, how do we actually change this? What is the way in which we can actually get a new product coming into the market? What could be the product? Can you guess? Camera, right? So that was, nobody knew that the camera is going to come, but everyone knew that there is a need for something different. Okay, the painting is not the best way to recreate the moments or precious moments. They wanted to get a new method or a new product which can actually capture this. And the idea emerges. So people actually, some intelligent or creative or innovative guy will come up with an idea. That idea may be very, very crude, may not be feasible, but somebody come up with an idea. Okay, so Da Vinci in 1490 wrote the first detailed description of camera obscura in his book Atlantic Codex. So that was the probably first recorded description of replacing a painter or a picture by a painter. So a painting was actually could be replaced by this. And this camera obscura involves punching a hole in a dark box and putting a light sensitive material on the other side. So the material science and the technologies were actually progressing, and there was someone who actually developed some material which can actually change its color, shape, or color or something when subjected to light. So this actually, this technological development led to someone converting that technology into a product. So that was when this camera obscura was actually proposed, where you can put light through a hole and that change the sensitive material. So the light sensitive material will change the image on the picture. So that was the first thought process on developing a camera. Then the first design of the camera obscura, was like this. Okay, this was the first design. Okay, so the proposal was done by someone, and then this person, Joseph Nipke, working on the camera obscura. So he was the one which actually tried to bring this into the product domain. I mean, the other one was more of a theory or an imagination. But then this person in 1800s, he tried to give this to a shape. So the technology, the product, and the function was very clear. You wanted to have that image captured. And how do you provide that was basically based on the function and the form of the product. So the function was more or less clear, but what form to be given was not known. And this person, he tried to develop it. Joseph Nipke, working on the camera obscura, he created the first one which can actually be used for creating images. And the first ever photograph, so I'm skipping few things and then we are going through the history of the camera. So the earliest known surviving photograph made in a camera was taken by Joseph, the same person, in 1826 or 1827. So the image depicts a view from a window at Lake Grasse, his hometown in France, captured on a quarter plate coated in bitumen dilute and lavender oil. So that was the chemical he used in order to get the image through the exposure. So that was the first photograph. And then once it comes, then there will be a lot of development taking place. People will start working on it and then try to develop. And the first patented Kodak camera was brought in 1888. Okay, so 1888, Eastman coined the slogan, "You press the button, we do the rest." So that was the first camera in 1888. And from there onwards, we had a lot of developments. The first cameras were very bulky, weighing about 120 pounds. They were also very expensive and were priced at $50. So you can imagine 100 years ago, $50 was a huge amount. And that was very heavy, huge, costly, and they were not affordable and could not be used by general public. So public could not use this. So now there is a need for modifying it. So there is a need to identify the problems have been identified. So you need to do an analytical method of design. You need to analyze the problem and then see how do we redesign the product, or how do we make the product more and more user friendly and more useful by the public. And that is where you get new designs coming up. So then we started getting a lot more products. The Kodak 2A, an autographic brownie, was manufactured in Canada from 1915 to 26. So that was after the Kodak camera, you got this, the previous one, you got this Kodak 2A, which was 1915 to 26, this was being manufactured. And again, there are a lot of issues with this, and most of them were black and white cameras, and huge, costly, and started working on the development. So parallelly, there will be a lot of technological development taking place. People will be working on the technological aspects, getting better and better materials, better and better the films, and then looking at how do you improve the image generated. So that is the way how it goes. And the first 35mm camera, Leica brought the first 35mm camera, and in 1924, we got this camera in Germany. Again, the electronic flash photography was introduced. Flash photography was introduced in 1931, we had the flash photography, and then a stroboscopic light for use in both ultra high speed and still photography was introduced. So somebody found that the images are not bright enough, so they started putting flashlight in the photos. And then we got a lot of high speed cameras, something which can actually record very fast movements. You can actually record the bullet movement. So that was again about the speed of camera. How do we actually capture high speed events? Then we have got auto exposure, that was autofocus. Earlier it was used to be focused by manually focus. And then we got autofocus coming into market. Again, that this Kodak Super 620 was the first still camera with auto exposure. Then we got this self-developing cameras. So now again it is coming back. That is, you click and you get the photo. That is the self-developing cameras. Okay, so in 1947, Edwin Land demonstrated instant film at the Optical Society of America meeting in New York. And he marketed the Polaroid 95, the first commercially successful self-developing camera. So Polaroid was the first commercial camera which can actually do the self-developing images. And then the first photo of Earth was taken in 1966, again using cameras. And then we have this instant photography, Polaroid, again, second generation of instant photography. And you have this flash memory coming up, because the memory was an issue with the camera. So the digital photography and flash memory was introduced. So non-volatile computer memory that can be electronically erased and programmed. That was introduced into the camera. So you can actually, now you have large memory size capable in the camera. And then inbuilt LCD screens, okay, that was the recent addition. You got in 1995, gave the LCD, because the development of LCD technology enabled having a display in the camera itself. That is the LCD technology coming into the camera. And then you have this transmission capabilities. So you take the picture and can be automatically transmitted to a destination. That is, you have communication capabilities integrated with camera. So you are having additional features of communicating the photo to a destination. And camera size started coming down. You have very small size cameras, very high capability, high image quality, and keep on reducing the size of the camera as well as the quality of the camera start going up. So if you look at, as the technology progressed, some of the old cameras went into its death, and new cameras came up in the market. So every time a new technology comes up, a new product comes, and the old sometimes survive, sometimes won't survive, and it have a natural death in the market. Now today's typical cameras, okay, these are very old now, 15 is not the current, you can have large megapixels, and you can have touch screen, you can have optical zoom, and you can have advanced processors, you can do a lot of image processing in the camera itself, you can do a lot of shake control or acceleration control, a lot of things are available in the camera which improves the quality of the images. So if you look at this birth and growth of the product, you can see at every stage there was a product which was providing a function, but then someone was either not happy with the product or somebody felt that this can be improved. Though they are happy, they felt that as the technology is changing, there is a potential for increasing the capability of the product. So these two, the synthetic method and the analytical method, sometimes work together in order to get better and better products in the market. Any product you take, you will see this kind of the birth and growth of a product. And the future of the camera is basically, probably we will be looking for, there are stereoscopic cameras already. Now probably a 3D vision camera, it's already there in the market for industrial applications. So in the near future, you may be getting a 3D camera, which is a consumer product. And maybe other features also may be coming with two lenses and two eyes and using it for various applications like human, and then probably interpreting many things from the images. So these things will keep on improving. As the technology improves, you will be getting better and better products in the market. And as the new products comes in the market, many old products will go into its natural death. Whenever you see a product, now this is what you need to look for. Okay, what actually led to its invention or the development of the product, and how these products grew over years and then reached the current state of the product. If you take any such product, you will see this kind of a natural growth of the products. Just to give you another example, we will not go into the details. Basically, you will see that a washing machine, how was the washing done earlier? Manually, we will put it in the water and then use some stone and let me clean the product, right? The clothes. And then it was sometimes in the Roman times, there was something called a fuller, which will whiten clothing by stomping on it in a bucket full of fermented urine. So that is the way how people were using the cleaning the clothes. And then we got something like this in 19th century. You got a product like this, which can actually be used for cleaning clothes. And then slowly it changed its shape, its feature changed. And then we got the electrical washing machines, and you got industrial washing machines. And now the washing machines are very highly sophisticated. You can actually have washing, you can have drying, you can have ironing also, right? Ironing is possible. Yes or no? So would you like to have an ironing in the washing machine? Pressing, right? Okay. So probably the next generation of washing machine. Now at present, what we use at home, most of the washing machines are only washing and drying, right? Drying in the sense, it will not do the drying, complete drying, right? Most of the washing machines available in the market will do rinsing, basically. They don't do real drying. But there are washing machines which can do drying operations, right? Now, what is the next stage that you are looking for? Ironing. And after that? Pardon? Folding, okay. Then? Keeping inside the cupboards. And then? Yeah, then after taking bath, you decide which dress you want, it will automatically come and then you will be able to wear it, right? Is it possible? Pardon? then we don't call it a washing machine. Something else will be part of the washing machine, right? So there is no limit for your imagination. Okay, and then, and that is a, this imagination is what actually leads to new products. There are already machines which can actually do ironing. Okay, you can actually take the feel the clothes, it will do ironing, and then it will fold it and can give it to you also. Okay, so what you need to look at is how each product comes into the market and what is the next stage of growth going to happen. So your first exercise in the lab, when you go to the lab, you'll be given a product, you'll be doing some exercise with the product, but you'll be asked to search for its history. What is the history of that product? Whether it is an ironing box, or it's a washing machine, or it's some other product. You need to look at what was the history of that product. How did it start? What was its earliest form? And what is the current form? And what was the change in its function? Was there any function change in the product? Or there was a additional function? Or the function remained same only, or the form of the product change. So this is what you need to look for in any product what you see in the future. Okay, as designers, one good understanding is basically how the things, how products evolve over a period of time. The evolution of products over a period of time has a lot to learn. You have a lot to learn from the evolution. You need to look at how the product is changing in the market and what drives the product to change its shape, color, size, or whatever it is. What was the driving factor which led to change in the product architecture or the product shape? So this is what you need to look for in the products. So let me close this by just telling you about a few things on the product. So every time you please check whether the function changed or the form changed, and if there is a change in the function and form, what actually led to that change in functions. Okay, so I'll just tell you, okay, this is basically for your information. Okay, basically there are a lot of design theories coming up in the market as you look at the history of the product development, and you will see that people like Archimedes, Hero, Bhaskara, Da Vinci, so these are the people who actually developed design theories or came up with better designs and new designs into the market. So probably they did not make the product per se, but they probably gave the idea or they developed some of the technologies to develop the product. So these are the people who actually contributed well into the history of product design. And one main observation is that the design theory is not yet a mature field. New developments are constantly being undertaken. So if you plot the design theory development, you can see that the design theory got a large jump during this period, and now still keep on increasing. So your new products coming up, new technologies coming up. So the design theory is still not matured. There are a lot of things happening in the market and in the technological on the research and development. And it is up to us, up to the designers, to come up with better products, new products which can actually change the market, or which can actually make a revolution in the markets. So to summarize, the history of methods and the science of product design are rich with tradition and wisdom. So you can see a lot of rich wisdom will be there in the historical development of product. And the ink on the historical manuscript is still wet. Many more chapters are yet to be written, contemplated, and analyzed. The big question is, are you ready to take up the challenge? Are you ready? Are you ready to develop new products? Okay. So then from next class onwards, we'll see how to develop new products. Of course, we won't jump into the product development. We'll slowly start with the step-by-step procedures and then see how can we contribute in the development of new products. Okay.